So, good afternoon, everyone. For those who are on the left side, maybe you want to kind of like come over here. So, because I'm going to be standing around this area. So, if you feel more comfortable to kind of like shift over a bit, I can at least see you guys. And if you start to like doze off, I can go faster. Okay. So, thank you for being here. One more session before the break, I think. And I'm going to kind of like cover a few things about agile and user experience for engineers. I'm going to set the expectations to say that I'm going to talk very little stuff about agile, right? The overall journey itself, I'm going to show you kind of like why I'm doing this, and the UX parts, I'll probably give a bit more attention to that. So the whole session is going to be kind of starting from an approach that is about exploring who am I, kind of like helping you understand that, what am I doing, and how do I do that, and why am I working on this. So maybe for yourself, you may want to draw this little diagram for yourself to kind of like help you maybe find your own path as a software engineer or someone who is interested in this area after this workshop, and you can talk to me about it, okay? So what I will not be able to cover today, because normally when I do this, this is a full day workshop or at least 2 days workshop. I'm not going to be teaching you about wireframes, A/B testing, personas. So if that's your expectation, you can ask me more questions later on. But in this 40 minutes, I'm not going to be covering too much of that. I'll leave some time later on for a Q&A so that we can kind of like have a conversation. Okay. Yeah. And again, there's no Lego. Unfortunately, I'm not working with Hugo. He's next door. So thank you very much for being here. I actually use Lego in my training, but for this, I'm not doing training, so I'm doing a talk. The company I work for is called The Collect Folks. There's 3 of us when we started 2 years ago. Today, there's 15 of us. We haven't had a chance to take a group photo, so it's a bit hard to show everyone in one place. There's Lina, Ruth, and myself. And just to give you a bit of background into who I am, I started programming when I was 7 years old. I'm 39 now, so I've done a fair bit of programming in my early days. I don't actually program anymore nowadays. I was telling someone yesterday that I used to learn a new programming language one every year, and I tried to do that, but the last few years has been very challenging, so it's a bit difficult. And I've gone through, as you can see, you know, a whole bunch in my career, from being a full stack developer to today. When I ever introduce myself to people, I actually say I'm a cyclist more than this, because it's easier to help people understand what I'm interested in, right? So I've worked with a number of companies across the region, and I've been coming on and off to Jakarta for about 7 years now. Sadly, I still don't speak a single, like I can't phrase a whole phrase in Indonesian yet. One day, maybe. Yeah, so I need to spend more time here. Work with quite a few people and kind of help people create the ideas of learning organizations. Anyone here is familiar with the idea or concept of a learning organization? The fifth discipline. Have you read this book before? Called The Fifth Discipline. If you haven't, the idea around the learning organizations is that there's 5 component technologies within there. There's basically the idea of systems thinking, personal mastery, mental models, building shared vision, team learning. And the way we do it at Collect Folks is that we use open space technology as a way to actually underlie this change, right? So there's about aspiration, understanding complexity, and reflective conversations to kind of like get you to a point whereby you can see the bigger picture. And this is what I wanted to share to you as my learnings over the last 17 years as a software engineer, and what I do today, which is slightly different in how I've done. Right, so I work with a number of companies, and just maybe to get ourselves warmed up a bit, right? You can choose to stand, you can kind of sit down for this, but can I get a show of hand of people who are product managers here, or think that you are product manager, product owner? So yeah, okay. Anyone who is a designer or a user researcher, should be almost none, because the ones I know are actually downstairs working. Anyone here considers themselves as a developer, software engineer? Should be almost everyone, okay. Anyone who is in QA testing? So minority still, okay. Anyone in business development? Should be almost none again. Oh, there is. Thank you very much. Anyone in marketing? Just curious. Okay, cool. So we've got a very broad portfolio of people here, and definitely it's going to be difficult for me to actually talk to everyone. So before we kind of like go too deep into this, you'll find that I deliver slightly differently from most people because I do a lot of training, coaching with people. I don't tend to do my delivery in such a way that I go on for the whole session. I actually want you to get something out of this. So if you have a piece of paper, you may want to write down like, what do you expect to learn from today's session, right, for yourself? 1 to 3 learning goals that you have. Is there any particular question that you have, burning question before you entered the room? Is there any challenge that you are facing as a software engineer or in your role? And why do you want to learn about Agile and UX? So I'll give you about 5 minutes to just take a piece of paper. If you don't have a piece of paper, take your phone, tap it in there. You don't have to tell me anything about this, but at least if you have questions after the session, your question is going to be ready there for you to ask, okay? So I'm expecting a lot of questions. So 5 minutes. Take your time, write down challenges, questions, expectations that you have for today. So it's good to see everyone is taking your effort to write it. Okay, I think most people should be done. The reason why I want to do that for you is that you've probably gone through a lot of talks today. You have had a lot of questions surfacing and bubbling. And I won't be able to interview every single one of them, but I'll probably be able to kind of like point to certain people. At least some of you will volunteer later on. Right. So the idea around UX or user experience is that we want to understand what you need. And I'm not going to be able to demonstrate it effectively today. Obviously, this is a kind of like a unique situation. But you guys have a lot of needs right now. You're thinking about a lot of stuff. And the whole day has probably challenged you in terms of what questions you want and what type of expectations you may have for an Agile conference for yourself, right? What do you want to learn? So it's good to take a moment to kind of like breathe, write it down, and later on I'll ask you some questions based on what I'm going to share. And let's see how much you absorb, what type of questions you still have, and anything that you want to kind of like explore further, we can still do later on, okay? So we're gonna get going. I want to share with you kind of like my journey towards UX work and the challenges of applying this. And as you can see just now, I started as a software engineer for a very long time. I've been doing that for a long while. I want to introduce to you this concept of shuhari. Again, anyone has heard of this concept, shuhari? I know it's a Japanese word, but I'll break it down for you what it means. Has anyone heard of this before at all? Okay. Yeah. So Ian, unfair because he's actually a coach, so he will definitely know it. Why I introduce this word is that usually when I do the training and coaching, especially for Agile, we want to introduce this concept. Like, you're not going to be able to get to agility straight away tomorrow. Like, after this conference, if anybody of you says that I'm like Agile ready, you know, I'm Agile certified, I don't tend to believe that, because if you can show me the journey you've taken through this and you can maybe talk about the shuhari concepts in your life, maybe it'll be easier to understand, do you truly understand this or not, right? So reading the manifesto is not enough. Reading the values and principles is not enough. Attending a two-day conference, attending a two-day training, I almost said scrum, but you know, any type of training and say you're Agile is probably not enough. It takes a journey to get to there. I didn't graduate and suddenly become Agile. I don't think the word was even available yet. The manifesto was still being written when I was doing my work, right? So it's very difficult. It's only recently somebody demonstrated back to me and said that the way you work is agile seems quite nonsensical to me, right? I've been doing work for the last 16 years, 17 years. I don't label that as agile. But as I look back at it, I can see certain patterns and emergence and lessons that I've learned that I want to maybe share with you today to help you see, is there something that you're doing? You probably are already doing it. Maybe you just haven't had time to sit down and listen to what is the possibility of this. So that's the agenda, okay? So that's breaking it down. Shu is about being in the beginning stage. Ha is about where you are actually beginning to branch out. And Re is when, as a student, you're not learning from other people, but from your own practice. There's actually a very good article, if you Google it, actually by the Martin Fowler from ThoughtWorks. So in a previous session, you saw his face just now, Martin Fowler. He's written a very good article about Shu Hari itself and why it really helps software engineers understand these concepts. And people who want to understand agility, very good concept to understand. Okay, so I've been fortunate to actually set up 3 companies in my first 10 years. Not all of them are successful. There's only one company right now on this list here. Oh, wait. This one, that's still alive, and it's a one-man show. I decided to like go to the basics and really keep it simple. Right. These are the companies I've worked with, some large companies, some small companies. When I was in Australia, nobody cared about any of this except for this list here. The ladies may understand this because if you watch a particular show, there's a very expensive shoe that is sold for about $4,000 a pair of shoe. Most of the guys here will have like your loss ready. Why would anybody buy a $4,000 pair of shoe? There are people who do it, and I was working with this group of people. Right. Oh. Something's wrong. Okay. When I first started my first company, you know, very excitable person in the early 20s with another partner, we quickly created a few bunch of companies, right? We were really excited about opportunities. The whole internet thing was going on, so we could code. We enjoyed coding. We enjoyed talking to people, and we created a whole bunch of businesses, right? So we had payments, we had credit card payments, we had SMS payment. Some were even deployed in Indonesia for field sales to use. So if you want to pay somebody, today you talk about GoPay, we were using something like a phone, SMS, and we can get payments straight away, right? We SMS the credit card. The most insecure way to do it, but it's possible, so let's try it. It failed dramatically because there's a lot of security issues. Traction wasn't ready, technology wasn't ready. Internet wasn't even very, very ready around that. So that's the failure points I could really learn. But one thing that really helped me understand the importance of research was that I got to work with a bunch of people. For those who have been to Changi Airport, one thing you may not have noticed is how clean it is, or at least for Singapore, how clean we pride ourselves on. It's actually done by an army of people who clean up everything, right? And to be able to do that, you need some level of inspection to do it. So we created a software to help people actually go through the inspection and understand how do you do that, right? So it really gave me the value of how do you think about users, you know? For someone who has never been doing this type of work before, how do I actually help them deliver better value in the software that I'm doing? So I really went down to the airport. I have actually a security pass that allows me to go into the tarmac where the planes are, and I walk around and see how do people do their work, right? So I'm a software engineer becoming a user researcher. I didn't know any of this. I'm just curious. I just really wanted to know, how do you deliver better software, right? So instead of writing more code or even writing more tests, let's talk to the users more. Let's go up one level, right? Not tests, not code, but what do really people really need, and try to understand that. Okay. Yeah. So during this period of time, I delivered over 85 projects. It seems like very little. I don't know if it's little or a lot to some people, but to me, it was a lot of projects to deliver. I wasn't very, very comfortable with that. So I put a very important question: how did I feel? Right? It's a question to ask yourself. When you are going through your career and you look at it today, and if you've gone through this many projects, how do you feel? Not the amount of code that you've written, not the lines of code you've written, not the bugs you've created, but how do you feel? I can share with you, I felt not that great. Right, I took a year off to play games. People still don't believe me when I say I took a year off to play games. But because of the work that I've been doing, enough savings, I've exited one company, I'm like, wow, let's play games for a year. And I learned EVE Online. So I played games for a year, learned about multi-distributed roles, and that was a really fun period of my time. And then I decided, let's try something new, right? Let's work for somebody. And I chose to work with a media company called SPH, and a classifieds business. eventually I worked with a company called iProperty, and that's where I got to work with people like Kermas, who's in front here, at Rumah 123. And I came to Jakarta, started visiting, but I also left and started to work with Bellabox, a cosmetics company. I don't like to work with female products. It's just in general, it's a very interesting audience because, well, number one, I'm not female. I don't use cosmetics. That's the best possible way for me to learn something that I'm comfortable with, right? So from a software engineer working in the cosmetics industry, interviewing female audiences, most of the people in this company, I was the guy number two to be hired. Not employee number two, guy number two, right, in a 40-person company. So that's what my label is. And then during this period of time, I found that, you know, what I felt in the first 10 years wasn't that great. I want to spend more time in community. So I worked with User Experience Singapore, Agile Singapore, to kind of do that. So for me, community, what you're doing today, 1 year, your first event today, I've seen this over the last 7 years, right, in Singapore and many countries. So I'm really proud that you guys are doing this for yourselves today, because maybe it'll let you kind of see what are the potential things that we can do as software engineers. You know, what can we do more than just writing code? So that's the message I hope to share with you. Again, very excited about business. Started a business for the real estate industry around service. Unfortunately, didn't do so well because the founder didn't understand talking to people is a very important thing. So he had domain knowledge, he had interest, but he didn't spend enough time actually talking to people. So I was really frustrated. As a software engineer who could write very good, well, in my opinion, very good code, writing tests, delivering projects, I couldn't seem to be able to find the right people to work with together, right, to deliver good products. And that's not a failure of the system in general, but that there's not many of people actually curious to talk to people. And yesterday at dinner, one of the VCs I was talking to said the exact same thing. There's too many people who are focused on actually creating products without looking at the real problems, right? So maybe the problems are actually around us, and maybe outside of Jakarta, for example, like travel to Bandung, Jogja, and take a look at those problems and see what can we do. So I want to share a story about the iProperty Group. All right. Anyone here is familiar with Rumah 123? Should be familiar enough. The office is nearby, right? Like somewhere there. Yeah. I managed to visit them. They used to be in Kemang, old days, even older. Yeah. Now it's nearby already. Yeah. So they shifted. Very nice office actually. Starting the whole community meetups. When we started, this was a team. There's about 50 of us. I think Kermas is in this photo somewhere. Yeah, you're in somewhere, yeah. So at that time, that was about 10 years old. They recently exited from the business, or at least not the founders even. The founders exited way before, right? REA Group in Australia, News Corp, bought them for Australian $751 million in 2015. It's nice news. Unfortunately, I didn't get a single cent out of that, so it doesn't matter at all. It's a story, though, I want to share about why is it important to think about that, right? So from a software engineer going into kind of like this world, and how do I actually lead the team, right? So the CEO came back from a conference and said, let's be mobile first. To you today, mobile first is the norm. 7 years ago, mobile first is actually still new. BlackBerry was still being used a lot. Android was still starting up. iPhone is not really in Indonesia yet, right? Pretty much that was the landscape of mobile at that time. And we want to be mobile first. It's kind of crazy, right? Everybody is using desktop browsers and we want to do that. Kind of weird thing to do. And so we started doing workshops, 6 months, 4 countries, 120 people, and focus on user experience as a topic, right? To identify where, how, who we will start with. And we started with an in-house approach to do that. So from a software engineer, because I was so troubled that the code that I'm writing is actually not delivering enough value, I transitioned myself into a place whereby I can talk to people within the company first, and also to the people outside of the company. Right. So I knew how to write the code, but that didn't matter so much. It wasn't about writing tests anymore. It's really about finding out what were the real challenges the company had. Right. So if for those who are actually kind of like interested into this path, it's a possible area you can actually explore. Right. Because you know how to deliver the code, you can actually work with many people to do this piece of work. Okay. So the process we started with, we had a mobile roadmap, we had a design strategy, we had personas, we had IA, task flows, prototyping, development, marketing launch, and measuring. This particular picture actually comes from the old Rumah 123 office. Kermas was there. That time, actually, we needed someone to translate everything that I said, almost. Yeah. So he was actually helping me translate most of these talks that I was doing. Okay. So we had a design strategy. a requirement analysis, a design concept, framing a design, detailed designing, and design guidelines and standards. So a whole bunch of things. It's impossible to cover this within a 40-minute session. Even if you take a photo, it's very difficult for you to actually break down into what it means, really. And I'll share my slides so you can figure out. But most of this here is equals to one book. Yeah, now wow. Yeah, yes. Wow, right. For me to be able to get up to speed, after being a software engineer for such a long time, I had to reread almost everything I had to know about this area. And I took the opportunity whenever I flew, whenever I traveled, to actually read and practice. Right, it's not about reading, it's not about attending conferences, it's about reading and practicing and also leading the conversation. Right, so if you are software engineering delivering code and you're feeling that you're frustrated about it, you know, you're not getting the right type of work that you're doing, you're not seeing the same value, maybe you want to kind of shift your mental model towards how could you solve this problem. Be a hacker, right, hack the problem. Don't make the problem worse by writing more code. Right, delivering more projects is not going to help you. Yesterday, I'm not sure whether this person is around, but yesterday I was in a meeting. They told me that their department had 200 people in IT. They had 50 developers. They have 120 projects for the year. That's the amount of scary code people are writing. 120 projects for 1 year, 50 developers. That's insane amount of waste, right? If these 50 developers spend maybe 50% of their time or more actually talking to people and thinking more about these type of processes, maybe that will be more interesting to do. And then when you code, that will be the stuff that you just want to finish up and deliver the value, right? So instead of the waste that's generated, maybe think about reframing the mental model towards how can we hack the process as a software engineer? How can I make this even more efficient? Right? Coding doesn't mean code in a programming language. How can you codify what you do into something that actually is a process you can replicate, and even better yet, do all of this and sit back and relax? That's what all programmers want to do, right? Write one line of code, even better, and then let it run for, not one line, maybe 10 lines of code, and kick back, have your coffee, take a break, and let it run. Like automation, that's the idea, right? But you can't automate some of this, especially for user interviews. So how do you actually get better at these areas? It's actually really practice that, right? So some of the learnings I had was be trained by somebody, get really kind of deep understanding into this area. You know, explore one more specialty. If you are a software engineer today, maybe explore the user experience world. If you are a designer, maybe explore the product management world. Even better, learn how to code. Right, learn a bit of that if possible. So communicate really often, work with all the different people, understand your budget. And we really were very quick in designing that. So we were very lean. Right, for a person who was in basically, I think we were around 300 people at that time, Arab Property, in four different countries. The team delivering this, because we were so focused on delivering value, understanding users, we were a very small team, right? We just had five people. I played the role of the product owner, so I transitioned from software engineering background, tech background, towards product ownership. I had one UI UX person, and I had one backend developer and two mobile devs. The two mobile devs covered everything from iOS, Android, and BlackBerry. And we delivered 6 apps in 9 months across the 3 countries, all at one go, right? So by doing a better process up front, we save a lot of time when we deliver the code. So that's an interesting proposition to you, right? Instead of trying to figure out writing more tests, writing better code, better quality code, well, you should do that. Maybe figure out how do I get better requirements? How do I get closer to the customer? How do I get more customer-centric and user-centric in the work that I do, right? So learning these skills will actually give you even more breadth to your career. Okay? So hopefully that's answering some questions for you guys. The next company that I work with, Bellabox, they exited in 2014 for $6 million. So the founders decided, we're kind of done with this, happy enough to exit to a large enough company like Fairfax Media. They own one of the largest newspapers in Australia. And they connect to about 700 brands, not a very big company, 45,000 paying customers in 2 countries. It was interesting for me because I got to explore kind of the finance side of things. But we really focused on UX as a key topic again in a hybrid approach. So we had a design strategy, very similar, but different in its own way. A much smaller company, but this time around we had to work even closer together to do that. So this person is actually a brand manager, doesn't code anything in his life. Right, doesn't know any of that. But he wanted to understand how do customers deal with us. So we're showing you an example of a customer journey mapping. Right, it's not about post-its, but understanding what are the problem areas when we look at the program itself, right? If you think about it, this is like pseudo code that you're dealing with, right? What are the problem areas? So before you even write a line of code, you are starting to look at the bigger process pictures, the system thinking around this, okay? So this, for example, was designed by the team based on team strengths. Was it agile? I think so, because the team designed it based on what they could do, not based on some prescribed scrum process, right? These guys were experienced. They decided, let's talk it through. We will all discuss what can we do together, and let's work on this together. We agree to time box it to maybe a 2-week time box still, and let's work through defining a problem, a design challenge, solutions, epics, build and test, right? So design, development, business, client, stakeholders, all do this. So early out in the sprints, around the first or second sprint, we already agreed together, how should we be working together? It's not blindly following a daily stand-up, a retrospective, and then a 2-week time box. It's not blindly following that. They actually agreed, how do we work together in an agile fashion, right, and deliver value to the business? And so everybody did this. This was actually a big piece around this big, and we pasted it into the project wall. So every day you can look at that and remind yourself, what are we doing here? How do we work together as a team? Right, so everyone, including the engineers, actually learn how to design. Right, they paired together with the designers paired together with the engineers. As much as possible, I encourage them to do that. By the way, they are not all from the same company. Some of them are actually vendors. I went through 7 vendors to find out who could work in an agile fashion. A company, a vendor with a $90 million revenue could not understand how to do agile, even though they said they could. It's an Australian company. If you want to know the name, I can give it to you later on. Right, so but the most interesting thing is that this small team of 2 different companies, a design company, a engineering company, and a client, we work together, we design this little process, and then we started, right? We were all in different offices. So if somebody tells you you need to be co-located to do it, I truly believe that it's about designing your approach, not worrying about where are you, and then increasing the amount of communication that you have to address the remote locations. Right. So for example, if you have team in Bandung, you have team in Jakarta, does it mean you can't do agile? Maybe it's challenging if you follow the prescribed way, but if you actually discuss it, we are in 2 different locations, what do we need to do to solve that? Maybe it should look something like, maybe not this, but you should have something that looks like this on your wall somewhere to let people remind themselves, how do we actually work together in an agile fashion in a different location? Right, so again, coming back to, as a software engineer, how do you solve a problem? Do you solve a problem by taking a requirement and writing code, or do you solve a problem by actually doing real problem solving? Right, hacking the thing, coding something up that allows people to do even more. Do you need to be a designer to do that? I don't think so. I think software engineers have an even better chance of doing it because you're fairly logical. You can actually write down the steps. You could do something like that. You can look at the bigger picture, examine the value, and try to deliver that. Okay, so when we got down to it, and we're working with fairly back-end systems, it's a young company, but suddenly they had legacy, right? They're working with a vendor, old vendor, and everything wasn't well written. And the problem really about systems like this is not about legacy systems, it's about legacy people that you have to deal with. You're about legacy customers and users, and legacy people resist change, and legacy customers and users don't care. As we were trying to run this project, we were trying to transition into a whole new platform, whole new team, we realized quickly that the problem isn't that. And how, if you really want to fail, is that if you try a phased approach, right? You design and implement the basics, you complete the features of the old system, and implement some new exciting features. The business really gets tired of waiting. If you do it piece by piece, you refactor the legacy system, you kind of like extract parts, and then you start working towards this uphill battle due to the friction between the new and old. Again, the business gets tired of waiting, right? So if you try to do any way to kind of like transition out of that, you need to really design that. Again, software engineers really play a big part. I was very fortunate. The guys I was working with were designing together with us, right? They were not writing code to solve the problem. They were thinking about, how do I solve this problem using what I know as a software engineer? Before I write the piece of code, how do I actually think about what do I need to do? Right, so it's even before writing the test, who do I need to talk to within the company to do that? then I'm standing too far away from this thing. So the key learnings are really that you want to kind of like get to a point whereby business as usual is really incredibly tough, and you want to maintain a focus on customer needs and don't be distracted too much by growth, right? So if you are at a juncture where a lack of focus can really delay your plans significantly when you do that. So in the communities that I was doing in parallel at that time, I was very fortunate to talk to people like Dan and Joe over at US Hong Kong. So they've been running a conference over there for a long time. And we ran a workshop designed for positive impact. Right. So software engineer going through all his life about writing code and finally coming to a workshop, not an agile workshop, but a workshop that asks, how can we design for positive impact? Think about that, right? As you're writing down maybe some notes for yourself. How will you do that? So I looked at the communities I was working in, product, UX and Agile Singapore. And we started really working together. This was the first Agile conference I volunteered at that back in 2012, I think, 12, 13, yeah. And then we have UXSG just last year. These are the volunteer group. These are product events. We do it at a more carefree location. We don't have a formal office that we do it in. And we kind of like really work together on that. So coming from a 80 plus project delivery, I don't really worry about number of projects I deliver today. I worry more about the people I'm helping, right? How many people am I actually helping with the work that I'm doing? Not about line of codes that I'm writing, not about the test that I'm writing, but how many people am I helping? So yeah, I did a quick calculation, all rough estimates. I'm not a statistics guy, but around 6 companies, 200 plus people I've trained during this period of time. I've worked with a few thousand people in community through the community efforts. And the best part is I got to cycle. Right, for those who know me, or at least will get to know me, I love talking about cycling more than actually this. That's 10 minutes, okay. And how do I feel about this during this time? So if imagine you were to write this down for yourself. Some of you are probably starting out your career, right? And maybe in your first year or second year, but maybe you want to write down this stuff now, then wait 10 years later, right? As you're doing this, ask yourself every year, how do I feel about the work that I'm doing? Is it about the lines of codes I'm writing? Is it about projects I've delivered? But how do I feel about when I go home, if I do my OT, my overtime, and I go home, how do I feel? Do I feel frustrated? I'm not seeing the sunset. Or do I feel happy even though the sun has set? Right. So what's the feeling that you have? And that's something that actually will help you think about the work that you do. It may not, maybe you continue to remain being a software engineer, but maybe you will change kind of the perspective of how do you want to be a software engineer using tools like user experience to help you, and how do you really be agile in that fashion? So think about those questions for the end, okay? So I started thinking about how do I really want to help people, and I kind of like brought this together. One of the companies I worked with here 2 years ago when I first started was actually a company called KMK Online. So some people here should be familiar enough with them. One of the platforms they have is video. I was having dinner with the guys last night, and they have really kind of like gone on out. They bought BlackBerry recently, and so the team is actually all over the place right now. Their whole sphere of work that they do, right? So they have a lot of interest in this area to do that, and a lot of investment today. So the team members, most of them when they attended this very first training 2 years ago, have never heard of UX before. So we invited the software engineers into the room. We invited the designers into the room. We invited people who were thinking about product into the room. Today, very nicely, actually 1 year ago, most of the designers are either the head of design running a UX role. They have hired at least a few more user researchers and designers into the role. Most of the engineers understand that. The great thing is they actually managed to actually try something called a design sprint. Any one of you familiar with the design sprint? Have you read the book Sprint before? Maybe, okay. So we're doing this with them and being realistic with them. So because of the business as usual, what that we were doing, we had 3 days out of 5 days, we were practicing with the sprint. The remaining 2 days, we could do whatever they want, right? So this was a training with real work to be done, right? So we focus on UX as a topic to identify again who, how, what, and why. And so again, this comes back to having many priorities in the business, they needed really a crystal clear approach to do it. So today, their team is all different. Right, compared to 2 years ago and even 1 year ago, the way they structure their teams with user research, as a shared resource to the whole company, it's very different. The engineers are actually one of the most, you know, interesting engineers I've seen there. Most of them are practicing pair programming already. Are they worried about the code they are writing? A bit less so, because they know that the people who are they're working with can deliver really good requirements to them. Right. So if you're interested to talk to them, really encourage you to visit those guys. Actually, I think they have an event on Saturday called GitCamp. So most of the software engineers, if you're attending, I'm going to be there. So it's going to be very interesting for you to listen to people who actually have experienced this as software engineers, who have gone through understanding most of this. And it's not in Singapore or the US. They are here in Jakarta who are doing this type of work. Right. So interesting people to have a chat with. I also work with a company called Singapore Press Holding, SPH. I used to work for them. Now they are my client after 7 years. Right. So very interesting for me to walk in back to the office as a software engineer, walking back into the office, meeting the senior management, and now doing training for them. Right. So from writing code for somebody towards training somebody, helping them understand how do you do this in the first place. So the 7 years cycle to do that. What's the next thing I'm going to be doing? I have no idea. I hope more cycling actually, instead of this type of interesting stuff. Right. So the key learnings that I got, sorry, the clicker is kind of like, right. So more communities that I really started to work with, in UX, I now travel more or less all the time. I don't get paid for doing the traveling, by the way. I get paid for doing the work. But when I travel, I meet people, I run the events, I run the conferences. This is in KL, in Singapore, in Genius on the 18th floor downstairs, over at SCTV. This is a product community, right? So when we do this, it actually helps me learn a lot more. So from writing code to helping people deliver software to helping people get connected through community, again, does it have anything else to do with writing code anymore? I think so, but it's very far away right now about the writing code. Right? Maybe one day I'll come back to writing code a bit if I figure something interesting within a product around this area. Right? So again, companies who have helped, 20 so far. I've lost count of the people I've trained over the last 2 years. People I still actively coach and mentor and take my time to do that, around 50, 30 plus, a few more thousand people have do it. But communities is now in 3 by 4 countries, right? 12 countries that I actually work on. I actually joke with some people that I'm probably away from my wife more and I spend more time in community. Why do I do that? Because I believe sincerely writing more code actually hurts us as a community, right? It doesn't create a lot of value if you write code that looks very good, tests that do very well, in performing very well, and give you high quality, but we are not asking the right question. We're not asking why enough. We don't understand how to ask why. We don't listen enough, right? So spending the time in community allows you to experiment in a relatively safe environment. Your boss could be around, but you can ask anything, typically, in such an environment. And you can be curious about it to learn, right? So I hope that once I'm done with this, at least by May next year, I can actually spend 3 months to go cycling and kind of like really enjoy that. So next time I come back here, I'll probably talk about cycling instead of this whole thing. And you can see it from Hugo's interview is that my whole interview is about how does cycling fit into Agile. And so for those interested, you can take a look at the InfoQ article. All right, so just to summarize this whole journey for yourself, and you may want to write this down kind of like for yourself again, because this is for me to help share to you. All right, so being siloed in tech in the early days wasn't very good, right? I didn't understand the wider business operations and it hurt the successful rollout of products my team worked on. But speaking to customers, stakeholders early and often, and taking the time off to learn something different was very valuable. As I did that, I learned that bridging people, right, not code, was far more important. And user experience was a very good way to do it. You may choose to use something else, right? Choose something that resonates with you. So it could be testing. It could be maybe in business analysis. It could be a product requirement they're interested in. Right, so find the right communities to enjoy. So now if you found Agile Singapore, find one more community to really immerse yourself in. Get to know the people in the community. Right, so even now with over 100 over clients, I'm still really learning everything new. I'm learning something from this one day and hopefully from tomorrow still. Right, I'm learning something, talking to people around and kind of like get to a point whereby you're really interested in what you're doing. I want to maybe get us to the Q&A part. Just that kind of like wraps up where I am. Although I may share some stuff that is kind of like interesting. If you're interested in some books, you should really be reading, right? I used to recommend The Mobile Frontier, but today this is probably not as relevant. But it's a book called The UX Team of One. So if working in a company, for example, like the one I mentioned, 200 people company, 120 projects, out of 200 people, there is one UI / UX person. So the ratio is 1 to 200 or 199. That's a very scary ratio to be designing products for and running 120 projects. Some of you could actually probably take up the role, right? Instead of writing code every day, dedicate maybe one day out of five to actually talk to a customer. If no one is talking to the customer or talking to the end user, right? There's a good book called Influence, The Psychology of Persuasion, and The Power of Positive No, right? How to say no and still get to yes. So it's an interesting book to actually read up on for those interested. Okay. Some of the tools I can use, I use a lot of free tools. I don't like paying for some of the tools that I'm using, so I encourage people to use the free tools first before you pay for a tool. Right, so Google Docs is probably the best, you can use that. There's diagramming tools like Kakao, prototyping tools like, you know, use paper. This is literally paper, not an app name. I mean the physical paper. Sketch, Mockflow, there's a few more. If you want to do, you know, visual design, maybe learn InVision. Some of the designers probably doing InVision with you already. And usually testing, you can use Silverback or Moire. And you can actually set up a camera rig really quickly. So you must have seen some of this around, right? So those who are really interested to follow up with me, you can use a piece of paper, write down your name, your email, share it with me so I can follow up with you. Most importantly, because of the work that I do, I truly believe that if I walk away from this with people in the room, it's very little value for you, right? So if you give me the piece of paper with your email and your name, I will come back to you in 30 days about what do you do about the things that you said you will be doing, right? Just to give you a check, a reminder. If you have done nothing, it's fine, right? But if you like me to follow up with you, I can provide that as a service or as at least a community effort to help you with that. Okay. Depending on what feedback that you have, you can choose to write it down, or maybe during the Q&A, you can ask me that question. Okay. Do you have any questions at all? Usually at this time, it's almost none. And to be fair, most of you had questions just now. So does anyone want to share the questions that you wrote down about 40 minutes ago? Because it's in your hands, it's in your phone. Anyone feels like, I would like to know something more? I can probably do two questions, I think, before the break. Yes. Yeah. So, there should be questions in this room. If you feel really that uncomfortable speaking into the microphone, you can pass the piece of paper to me and I'll read it for you. I won't even have to say your name. For a paper airplane, just throw it out. Okay, maybe let's do this. Do you at least enjoy this session? Like thumbs up, neutral, down, just to get a sense. My feelings don't get hurt easily, don't worry. This agile, right? You want to get feedback. If you don't ask this question, you don't get to improve. I don't get to do this one more time. So if you don't enjoy this session, I don't get to improve. If you don't ask a question, I don't get to improve. At least one question. Then maybe that will get the ball rolling. There you go. Yeah. Do you need a mic? Your name?
My name is Nico. Nico.
You're a software engineer or?
Software engineer. Yep. I'm right now in a startup company. We have quite a big client and our developing team are quite small. Mm-hmm. So we have many requests. All of our developers have multiple positions, multiple description jobs.
Yeah. Okay. So you're interested in a team where it's fairly small, very multidisciplinary, people are doing almost everything all the time, and yet you have a very big client with multiple requests coming in. Yeah. Anyone else in the room has the similar setting, like you are in the same situation? Not the same, but maybe similar enough. Like you are in a team that is very small, dealing with multiple requests all the time, and also in a very dynamic team. Anyone else in the room similar enough? Similar. So there are some people with similar areas. So again, it comes back to the point, is writing more code making you feel better? Not really, right? After you listen to all of this, what do you think is the one thing you will change? So you think that having some fixed rules or standardization allows people to deliver better, right? So that is probably the one thing you should be doing. So the funny thing is that most of you know the answers when you're unhappy with something. And if your boss was in the room or not in the room, I don't care. You can either change the organization or change the organization. Right. So you can either take the first step, which is change organization, maybe do the thing that you said, right? Write down some rules. Maybe the rules could be something that I described. Maybe we should talk to the users first. Or it could be as simple as drawing out the process of how we should be working together. But first, maybe you want to identify the challenges first. Like today we are talking on, let's say, 100 change requests every month. We deliver 50 of them, right? So don't do more coding. Do some mathematics to show that this is actually hurting us more. And maybe influence some people to say that, let's have a discussion of how can we improve on this. So there's no coding involved. There's really just communication. And for those who have been looking at the Agile Manifesto, the first line, I wish I was wearing the t-shirt because I have a t-shirt that says the exact same thing. Individuals and interactions over processes and tools. What you're asking for me is to give you a process and tool. What I'm saying to you is to have individuals and interactions over that. Right? Talk to the people you're working with. Talk to your clients, if you can. And find out, how can we change this? But if you do more coding, it's probably not going to help. None? Okay. Yeah. Sorry. We spent too much time on the last question. Yeah. But thank you very much for the question. And thank you, everyone.